I'm here to present the yoga of radiant presence. Absolute depth, the absolute most subtle, most profound aspect of reality itself, of the intrinsic yoga of reality itself, relating with itself, being with itself, its own intrinsic process, is simply this. What could be simpler? This sits right here. That's the absolute depth of it. That's the absolute most profound aspect of it, as well as the simplest. The mark of realization is you can stop there. The mark of being a very advanced yogi is you can almost stop there. The mark of being a perhaps slightly lesser yogi is, yeah, but what about... This obviously is already what it is. It is complete. Nothing can be added to it, nothing can be taken away from it. It is absolutely inclusive. There's nothing omitted, nothing missing. It is absolutely autonomous. It depends on absolutely nothing. And if there were anything else, it would depend on it. So it is its own mother, its own father, its own root, and its own tree. So on and so forth. And yet, it's right here. This actuality that is right here. It's completely blatantly obvious. There's nothing hidden about it. I would say nothing subtle about it, but that might not be really useful information, really clear information, because of course it is actually infinitely subtle. Which is where the challenge is in yoga come up. So this that's here is completely obvious. This complete obviousness is also infinitely subtle. So you can be with this obviousness and move into it. In fact, it spontaneously tends to move into itself with more and more and more merging and opening into subtlety, into seeming elaboration, into seeming nuance, into literally infinite depths of profundity and meaningfulness and flavorfulness and implication and so on and so forth. But none of that departs from this. It's like looking at the ocean, you know, you're sitting here at the beach, you look at the ocean, you're looking at the surface of the ocean. But you can go into the ocean, you know, supposing you're equipped to do so, or you're disembodied in a thought experiment or what have you. You can go into the ocean, and you can just keep going and going, and there's no limit to what you can discover. But it's just the ocean. It's the same thing you were looking at when you were just looking at the surface of it. And that's this. That's what this is like. It is not, it has no dichotomy within it. It is not this or that. It is not either or. It is not superficial or deep. The depth is the same thing as the superficial. The superficial is the same thing as the depth. So wherever you are with it, you haven't gone anywhere. It's not like an ocean, which presents as if it's a three-dimensional system. You know, there's a surface and there's the depths, and the surface is here and the depths are there, and the depths aren't at the surface and the surface aren't at the depths, even though it's a continuum, and so on and so forth. This is not like that. This is stranger than that. You go into the depths and you haven't left the surface. You go to the surface and you haven't left the depths. It's a very, very strange actuality that is not modelable, it's not conceivable, because of this intrinsically, from a logical point of view, paradoxical nature that it consists of. And it is this that presents all the conundrums, because as human beings, we've been conditioned very heavily into a conceptual mode and a semantic mode of distinguishing between this and that, as we're all totally familiar with, and which we consider useful and certainly, you know, may be useful within its gamut. But what this is doesn't work like that. What this is not structured like that. And so, an aspirant, a yoga aspirant, approaches this, and the natural impulse is to approach it the way you would approach anything. Well, let me figure this out. Give me the data. Give me the info. What do you do? You know, what is it? What isn't it? And all of these kinds of questions. And it's just not like that. Those kinds of questions based on differentiation, based upon distinguishing between this and that, just don't apply to this. So the biggest hurdle for the yogi is coming to see the way that this is so. The way that everything is both and. There's no either or, everything is both and. So however it is, it can also be another way, and another way, and a myriad of ways, and no way, and everything, without there being any contradiction at all, or any disjunction at all. This is a seamless, inclusive continuity, which never departs from itself, regardless of the apparent elaborations that seem to be presenting experientially. So it demands learning, or actually recognizing, a different mode of intelligent engagement. It doesn't need to be learned, because it's a mode of intelligent engagement that has always been occurring ongoingly, and that we're all intimately familiar with, but most of us are not in the habit of acknowledging it, because it occurs what, in terms of our parent psychology, could be called unconsciously. And we're used to identifying with and thinking and functioning in terms of a conscious mentality approach to things, with analytical thought and conceptualization and modeling and abstraction and so on and so forth. But even as you've been doing that, you've also actually been engaging with the inherent intelligence, which is the mode of the intelligence that this consists of intrinsically, and that you are, that manifests you, and that is of course a manifestation of what you are, that is always fully in operation. But again, typically it's not recognized or not acknowledged, because typically we're so distracted by these conscious, analytical, abstracted modes of approaching things. So this is a wonderful foot in the door. This is a wonderful shortcut. Since you're already doing this other mode of engagement, since you're already completely engaged with with your actuality as the inherent intelligence, it's simply a matter of recognizing that's the case. You don't actually have to do anything. You don't actually have to learn anything. There's nothing new that you need to acquire. There's nothing you even need to forget or ignore. Simply come to recognize this more primal, fundamental, exclusive, infinite mode, which has always been in operation. So you could say it's a matter of instead of fixating upon conscious analytical modes, one relaxes into what feels like an expansive, inclusive, very vibrant, very vital mode, but it's a mode that is not abstracted. It's a mode that is not conceptual. It's a mode that does not consist of intellectual and mental models of things, but the presence of the things itself. As all of you know, I refer to this process as noticing. So one comes to notice this other mode that has always been in operation. And we're actually very, very familiar with it. We just typically don't acknowledge it as valuable. We don't think of it as anything. We just think of it as, well, there's experience, sure, yeah. Of course I'm experiencing, but what's happening? Whereas the experiencing itself is this other mode. The experiencing itself is the intrinsic hyperfunctionality of reality itself.
Peter, is experiencing and presence, are those interchangeable words?
Yes, but we're getting ahead of ourselves.
Okay.
I'll talk a little while more, and then we can have some discussion. I think, unless I run out of things to say. If I start repeating myself, somebody throw something at me.
There's no such thing as repeating.
Either an advanced yogi or a wise ass, I don't know.
I'm an advanced ass.
The subtlety and the insidiousness with which the inherent identifying principle, let's call it, or functionality of consciousness, can identify with conscious modes of functioning and conscious identifications is also very challenging. Because even as one makes profound headway in moving into subtlety and coming to notice and recognize and settle into the more profound intrinsic inclusive beingness that experience consists of, there can be still a more subtle identification with rational analytical modes that can be operant in the background, or maybe not so in the background, but that can enable one to, that can serve as a kind of an anchor or a kind of a, you know, something that one can seem to keep stubbing one's spiritual toes on in the course of one's, you know, yogic wandering. And so this is another aspect of the challenge of yoga. So even when one has, you know, made a major progress in recognizing the intrinsic nature, there can still be umbilical, keeping one tethered to one's habitual identification with conscious modes and so on and so forth. And so the process of yoga consists of looking at all of these issues in every mode, looking at them analytically, looking at them directly in terms of what they actually are, until ultimately true seeing can occur, which consists of simply seeing this as it is, which of course includes conscious modes, it includes abstraction, it includes intellectualization, it includes identification, it includes all these things, at which point all of these apparent submodes cease to be an issue, cease to be a problem, because they seem to actually be this itself. Because one recognizes that nothing can depart from this. And so if one's caught up in one's trivialities and one's absurdities and one's egoic identifications, who cares? Because it is this itself, which is the high watermark of yoga, and it's what realization looks like. You know, it's very easy for yogis along the way to still, again, largely do, I'd say exclusively do, perhaps, to this, you know, perhaps subtle clinging to an analytical orientation. It can be very easy to hold the subtle notion that one needs to get away from get away from that and get to this. One needs to stop that and get to this. And you get out of the intellectualization. One needs to get out of the conceptual and egoic identification, and or de-emphasize it, or turn it down, or shut it off, or whatever, and get to this over here, which is the real thing. And that's just not true. It's not actually like that. But it can be tricky to come to see that it's not like that, evidently. And so this is an overview of the issues that we are here to look at over the course of this weekend. It's very important to not, in practical terms, in tactical terms, it's very important to not orient to your aspirations. Don't orient to, oh yeah, I get that, it's all one, it's all great, you know, cool. It's very important to keep very realistically grounded in the actuality of your own orientation. Because that way you will be engaging with it directly, which is the process whereby it can erode itself in within its own nature. to that end, I strongly recommend and invite you during the course of this weekend to anything that at all, any yeah buts that are in your, that come to your mind, anything that seems to be an issue whatsoever in any way, large or small, please bring it up and let's talk about it, let's look at it, because it's that kind of honest reality check engagement with where you're at, with what things are actually like for you, that is going to be effective in progressing your yoga, as opposed to, you know, a kind of a hopeful, idealistic aspiration to, oh, I get it, it's all, you know, I see, it's, you know, it's, this is great, that's it, you know. But if there's still any kind of a little issue floating around in your karma, you won't it will be much less efficiently processed than if you sort of own it, settle in with it, live with the actuality of it, and then it's much more efficiently engaged with and processed.
You're describing like if you get too enthusiastic with your aspirations, that's a concept and a belief.
No, not necessarily.
But it's not.
No, aspiration's fine. Just keep it in perspective of what's really going on with you.
I thought what you were saying was we wanted like get more precise about what's happening.
Yes, precision.
But
specific.
It seems to me like having the aspirations is more putting it in the future, be less precise.
Well, aspiration seems like it would be that way analytically, but aspiration isn't really that. Aspiration is one's own intrinsic intoxication with the wonderfulness of everything.
By the way you said it, doesn't seem like it's a problem.
It's not.
It's just that it doesn't do what?
No, there's no dichotomy.
Oh.
The aspiration is fine, and even having even wallowing in your aspiration and having a denial mechanism about your issues is also fine. It's not like that's evil or something. But if you do that, that's a less efficient yogic engagement than an engagement that is settling in, very specifically with what's going on for you.
We're always working with concepts, right?
Concepts are always present, but the concepts are actually a very, very small portion of what's present.
What's the difference between noticing and conceptualizing? We almost always have a commentary about what we're noticing.
Yeah. Conceptualizing is not a problem, but again, conceptualizing is a smaller event in a vaster context, and noticing is noticing that fact, noticing the vaster context within which conceptualization occurs. And again, it's not a dichotomy. You're not trying to stop the conceptualization. You're noticing that even though I'm thinking about all this stuff, where's that happening? What's the context in which that's happening, which is all this, which is not a thought, which is not conceivable.
I remember once it was a painting, like an old master Dutch painting, of an artist painting a painting, and then the painting, and the artist painting a painting. You see what I'm saying? It's
sure.
Like a house of mirrors there.
Yeah.
Anyway, thanks.
I'm you, Hannah.
Yeah, I'll get it too.
I'm being arbitrary. I'm not.
Anyway, so.
Come on, bare your soul. It's no big deal.
No. I've embarrassed myself enough over the years. See, anyway, during waking up, when I'm awake during the day, it's this is larger. This is the whole can be is the whole thing. When I'm going to sleep at night, and let's say if I'm having problems sleeping, it's sort of like I'm not even running it, but there's this like wrestling natural about if I'm having a hard time sleeping. Of just in my, it just collapses on itself. Now, I'm talking about yogic strategy about this.
Right.
Now, there's one point thing I could, it's just to see this, it's presence. I mean, it's there. So, it's present. So,
yes.
One could just, and that thing's about the only thing available. I can't go to a larger context because I'm going to sleep where I'm shutting down, it's going this way, as opposed to staying out.
Right.
And seeing in a larger context. So there's no larger context there. It's just sort of, it gets kind of myopic.
Right.
So I was wondering if you could talk about that.
Yes. This is a very good issue that I think shows up for everyone in many guises. It's the notion that expanded is better, expanded is superior. Mm-hmm. And collapsed and introverted and self-referential obsessive is bad or is a detraction from the expansion, and this is not the case. The fact that it can occur means it is actually infinite radiant presence. So contraction and obsession and neurotic reactive emotionality and all of that is in fact radiant presence. So it is the finish line, it is the goal, it is the prize. And in terms of strategies, what you've mentioned is the highest approach, which is see that it's radiant presence. See that, what is it? Okay, here's this old thing going on, and I'm sucked in, and it sucks, and I hate it, and you know, I wish I would die. Okay, great. So I may be taking it to an extreme, or not. I don't know.
Putting words in his mouth.
So anyway, all this is going on, right? But what is it that's present? How do you know it's going on? Yeah. Something is here. Something is present. And what is it that's present? It's, you know, it's, again, it's, there's no words, of course, but you could say, well, it's energies or, you know, whatever.
It's definitely dynamism.
Dynamism, yeah. Energies, mm-hmm. You can throw all sorts of labels at it if you like, it doesn't matter. And all of that comes under the heading of what I classify as radiance. So radiant presence, I'll define our terms now that we're already well into the day. Radiant presence is a way of seeing this, what it is. It is present, it is actual, it is here, it is now, all of these kinds of notions. You know, presence is undefinable, but it's completely self-verifyingly obvious. And yet, presence never shows up naked, does it? Presence never shows up as nothing. It always shows up as something, as anything, as everything. And that's the radiance part of it. Now, radiance is not separate from presence. Presence is not separate from radiance, as using two words, radiant presence, may seem to imply. But again, with our language, which is based on drawing distinctions, unfortunately these implications are built into the structure of it. But radiant presence is this. This is radiant presence. And whatever it looks like, it is that. So again, seeing that it is that is yoga. And to any degree you can see that it is that. So the simplest way, or let's say that, you know, perhaps one of the most direct ways of accomplishing that, when any experience seems to be present and occurring, it's like, what is here? Something is present. What is present? All of, you know, then you can have your own narration in terms of verbalizing it. Oh, there's all these weird vibes or weird energies or obsessions or whatever, identifications, blah, 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 which is all a euphemism for what? It's all a euphemism for experiential qualities, which are not amenable to analysis. You can't say what they are. You can't pin them down. You can't get to the bottom of what they are. It's, you know, they seem so obvious and blatant and undeniable when they're present, but you go looking for them, you can't actually find them. So they're infinitely weird. And this applies not just to problematic or difficult experience, although, of course, that's usually when we're looking for remedies. But it applies to any and all experience. You know, and as I've said many times, in terms of developing the skill of sort of shifting gears, noticing, and looking at, rather than just being with the phenomena in its own implicit terms, sort of pulling back and looking at it and saying, okay, well, what is here? What is actually here that seems to be all this? And seeing the radiant presence. It's easy to train in that when it's not a problem. And it's most easy to train in that when it's not just a problem, not a problem, but when it's also an area of your experience that you have no investment in or idea about whatsoever, something you completely don't give a shit about. You know, as I've said many times, you know, find a blank portion of the wall that you have absolutely no concern about one way or the other. You don't like it, you don't hate it, you don't think about it, you couldn't care less, and do that exercise with that, because you're working with something as nearly neutral as possible in terms of your identifications and obsessions. And then you, so it's less liable to be distorted by your own investments, or convoluted by your own, the complexity of your own investments. But again, and as you build up chops or skill in doing this, then it can become easier and easier to see that same perspective in more challenging circumstances, like, you know, or in the worst case circumstances of complete obsessive, you know.
Yeah, I find that during I got chops more during the daytime. You know, let's say if I'm terrified, well, it's happening in a bigger context. There's a lot of other stuff going on. And like you said, you don't have to switch gears. You don't have to resolve one thing before you move somewhere else. It's all available. And it's sort of just, the whole thing kind of, it's almost like dilutes it. It's almost like putting dye in the water to sort of dilute it.
Yeah.
Whereas when you're sleeping, and that's why I'm saying it kind of shuts down, then it, that kind of thing in the larger context, well, it's still available if I want to stay awake. But if I want to kind of try to fall asleep, somehow making peace that that's also ready, it's just this thing I'm collapsing into. As funky as it is, it's still present in the presence. Do you see what I mean? I mean,
yes.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. Anywhere you've noticed radiant presence is not limited to one state or another state experientially. please mute yourself. Radiant presence is not limited to one state or another. It's not true in the waking state, or true in the sleep state, or true in deep sleep, or true after death. It's always true. It's the only truth. It's the only thing that is here. And so, as you train in coming to recognize it, that applies outside of any state. So if you're in the waking state and you recognize radiant presence, you're not recognizing it in the waking state, because the radiant state doesn't exist in the waking state, it exists outside of it. And that will spontaneously translate into all of your experience. You know, perhaps seemingly over time or what have you. So the trick is to have that recognition whenever you can. And it will be cumulative.
It's not limited to a state.
No, of course not. It's outside all states. All states occur within it.
Yeah.
It doesn't occur within a state. The waking state appears because radiant presence is, as with the sleep state and dreams and so on and so forth.
So, this is an extension of what you're talking to Stan about, but so what's happening for me is that I'm in a state that's like kind of all gripping. I'm dealing with loss, I'm dealing with sorrow, I'm dealing with, like, I'm doing my entire last 30 years identity, figuring out which parts of it to hold on to, which parts are accurate, which parts are useful. And, you know, I luckily before everything's falling apart, I have been with you for a while, I've done some other stuff, but, you know, so I kind of know that the stuff that's happening isn't me, it's just part of subset of radiant presence and all that is. But boy, it's really, and part of me just wants to let the feelings pass through, especially sorrow, because it's not one of my feelings that I, you know, allowed myself to experience much in my life, but it, sometimes it just feels like a tidal wave.
Yeah. Well, the answer is you can't know what to do. You do what you do, and there's no, not necessarily any antidote to anything. Yoga or spirituality is not actually about solving problems.
Yeah.
It's about eliminating problems, which paradoxically doesn't necessarily solve them. But you move into a condition where the events that are occurring aren't problems, even if they're still occurring. again, perhaps by degrees over a course of time. So all conditions are temporary. All conditions appear and disappear and morph and change. And there's no way, well, let's say there's no simple way. There may be a way with very advanced spiritual athletics, which is not really the topic of our work here, to try to address or steer the course of the way things appear. Which is, of course, not necessarily happy news when one is in the midst of difficult circumstances. But it's ultimately happy news in the long run, or ultimately. It is ultimately happy news. And of course, the ultimate is not, doesn't mean necessarily in some far future. The ultimate is also now, again, by degrees in terms of how relevant it seems or how accessible or immediate it seems. You know, basically, as we're all familiar with, you sort of have to go through what you have to go through when you're going through it. And there's, you know, and ultimately this is understood and seen very clearly to be an intrinsic aspect of the nature of this, an intrinsic aspect of the apparent process of this. It, one can imagine if one hypothesizes that it has or is a process, which is, you know, very, it's a very tenuous notion, so. But anyway.
Is there any, I was going to say truth, but to that Bible, the quote in the Bible, it says, in the beginning was the Word.
Sure. But the word in the Bible means the inherent intelligence. Mm. Okay. Or you could say it means the radiance, they're one and the same. The beginning is presence. So in the beginning is presence, and then was the Word is the radiance.
I don't know.
We must be getting stir crazy if we're quoting the Bible.
I thought that was my book.